Please bear in mind that this is just meant to provide an overview of the topic and should not be interpreted as medical advice. If you believe you or someone you know may have DiGeorge Syndrome, please seek your physician. If you believe one of our patients may have DiGeorge Syndrome, please check the latest protocols. What is DiGeorge Syndrome? DiGeorge Syndrome is a congenital malformation cause of immunodeficiency. That is, because of a gene defect, you end up not forming all the organs you should, or at least not in the right way. It can be grouped along with velocardiofacial syndrome, Kahler cardiofacial syndrome, and conotruncal anomaly phase as the three diseases caused by the 22q11.2 deletion. This just means that on chromosome 22, on its long arm, when you talk about chromosomal arms, P stands for petit, short in French, and Q is just the next letter after P and stands for the long arm of the chromosome. 11 means region 1, band 1, and 2 means subband 2. So, when you lose this specific part of chromosome 22, you can develop any of these four diseases: DiGeorge syndrome, velocardiofacial syndrome, Kahler cardiofacial syndrome, or conotruncal anomaly phase. What happens is that this gene is involved with the development of the third and fourth pharyngeal pouches. Pharyngeal pouches, along with pharyngeal arches and pharyngeal grooves or clefts, are part of the pharyngeal apparatus. All the portions and the complete meaning of the pharyngeal apparatus is beyond the scope of this video. However, when we look at an embryo, we can see, just caudal to the head, on what would be the anterior face of the neck, a series of sacs where the pharynx would be. These are the pharyngeal arches, which is respective pharyngeal grooves and pharyngeal pouches. Each of these is going to develop into a different structure from the head to the mediastinum. However, patients without the genes on region 11.2 of the long arm of chromosome 22, such as those with DiGeorge syndrome, can't adequately develop pharyngeal pouches 3 and 4. If you have problems with developing an embryological structure, you will also face malformations in the organs that should have arisen from them. The third pharyngeal pouch forms the inferior parathyroid gland and the thymus. The fourth pharyngeal pouch will lead to the formation of the superior parathyroid glands and the C cells of the thyroid. A bit counterintuitively, the superior parathyroid glands comes from the inferior pharyngeal pouch, the fourth. In the end, what really matters is that if we can't adequately develop pharyngeal pouches 3 and 4, we won't get a thymus or parathyroids, or we will get deficient versions of these organs. So, we will present with thymus aplasia or hypoplasia and parathyroids aplasia or hypoplasia. Because the third and fourth pharyngeal arches, which are associated with the third and fourth pharyngeal pouches, will eventually form the carotid arteries, the right subclavian artery and the arch of the aorta, as well as the soft palate, 5 muscles of the pharynx, and some cartilage, you can also present with abnormalities or malformations of the heart and great vessels in up to 74 to 80% of cases, and also face malformations such as cleft palate. For somewhat unknown regions, the deletion of the genes on 22q11.2 is also strongly correlated with neuropsychiatric disorders, especially schizophrenia. So, this leaves us with a disease that arises from the developmental failure of the third and fourth pharyngeal pouches, leading to thymus hypoplasia, parathyroids hypoplasia, abnormalities of the heart and great vessels, abnormalities of the face, and neuropsychiatric disorders. These manifestations are often remembered through the mnemonic CATCH-22, which stands for cardiac defects, abnormal facies, thymic hypoplasia, cleft palate, and hypocalcemia. 22 then stands for the 22q11.2 deletion. Personally, I had never heard of catch-22. However, if it has a meaning for you, feel free to use the mnemonic. Personally, I prefer just to think that as a malformation of the third and fourth pharyngeal pouches, we will have defects in all the derivative structures from these two pharyngeal pouches. The lack of parathyroids then will prevent the synthesis of parathyroid hormone, leading to lower levels of calcium in the blood or hypocalcemia, which can present with Schwolsteg and Rousseau signs, or in infants, maybe seizures and tetany. This can be the first sign of presentation, since the immunodeficiency won't manifest until 3 to 6 months once the mother immunoglobulins wear off. It's also the most common description of question stents. A neonate presenting with seizures and very low calcium that has a cleft palate or a cardiac abnormality. The thymus aplasia or hypoplasia in its own term will lead to the main manifestation of this disease, T cell deficiency. Without a thymus, you can't mature T cell and therefore you have few or no T cells in the infant and later in the adult. You may even have hypogammaglobulinemia or a deficiency of certain antibodies because the B cells can't class switch since there are no T cells for them to interact with. Without T cells, you can't class switch. Due to the immunodeficiency, sepsis is the second most common cause of death in patients with DiGeorge syndrome. The first is heart failure from the cardiac malformations. The most common ones are tetralogy of Fallot, truncus arteriosus, and interrupted aortic arch in infancy, and ventricular septal defect, pulmonary atresia with ventricular septal defect, and other conotruncal defects after 2 years of age. Now, this is obviously the age of diagnosis and not the age when the problems have arisen, since they all came from malformations in the embryo. The disease is sporadic in more than 90% of cases, meaning it results from a de novo deletion. There is no similar deletion in the parents. However, about 10% of cases are inherited from one of the parents as an autosomal dominant mutation. This results in an overall incidence of DiGeorge syndrome from 1 in 4,000 to 1 in 7,000 births. The diagnosis is usually suspected when an infant with cardiac malformation presents with a low absolute lymphocyte count on complete blood count, or when he presents with hypocalcemia on birth. The hemodynamic manifestations of the cardiac abnormalities and hypocalcemia are the first signs in the neonatal period. This low lymphocyte count, then, should be investigated through flow cytometry to evaluate the T and B cell counts. In DiGeorge syndrome, we would expect to see a normal B cell count and a very low or no T cell count. We will then confirm the diagnosis through genetic studies. The two most common of these are the Array Comparative Genomic Hybridization, ACGH, which is the most appropriate test nowadays, and the Fluorescent In Situ Hybridization, or FISH, which is more readily available and less expensive, but may miss smaller deletions that the ACGH would detect. Imaging studies may be used to look for cardiac or pharyngeal malformations. However, they are not indicated to evaluate thymic size. Thymic size is itself a poor predictor of immune function. The only caveat here is that the complete absence of thymus, thymic aplasia, is way more severe than a poor thymic development or thymic hypoplasia. Treatment will involve calcium and sometimes vitamin G supplementation for the hypocalcemia, surgical repair for the cardiac defects, surgical repairs for cleft palate and other facial defects, and prophylactic antibiotics and antifungals to prevent infection. In patients with the severe and rare thymic aplasia, an early thymic transplant or a hematopoietic stem cell transplantation can show some benefit. Keep in mind as well that, just as with so many other immunodeficiencies, live vaccines are typically contraindicated in patients with 22q11.2 deletions. They are also contraindicated in other household members, since they can shed the live organisms to the patient. Thank you very much for your attention on this video and for choosing to spend your time with me. If you enjoyed it, please feel free to check other medical review topics on this channel, and I hope to see you on the next video.